this is what I mean by known unknowns. You have something that's known, you have something that's unknown. You have incomplete information. How do you put bounds on your ignorance? How can you constrain what you don't know using what you do know? And as an example, we're going to take something that was a big deal about 2 years ago when the experiment that I work on, the Large Hadron Collider in Switzerland, was getting ready to turn on. And I guess, you know, it's Halloween, so this is kind of a scary topic. I guess that's my attempt at, you know, it's the idea that, you know, might the LHC destroy the world? That's the, and this was, of course, you know, a big deal 2 years ago. Now, in practice, what's actually happened, well, the LHC has actually been running for about 7-8 months now. At least we know that's 7 or 8 months we're okay. And half power, true, but still at energies that had never been reached in the lab before. So in that sense, it's still kind of unknown. And of course, since it did start up, it's been running. At some point, somebody somewhere had to convince enough people in the lab that this thing would be safe, and that it wouldn't, you know, destroy the Earth. So we're going to go into two things today. One is, all right, well, you know, these ideas that it might destroy the Earth, we're going to look at actually a few of those ideas and just see what there is to them and see what the possibilities are. And then the second half will be, all right, how do scientists deal with this? How can we possibly say with certainty that this machine is not going to end our existence? So, all right, so what is the Large Hadron Collider? This is an outline here of the ring that's in, it's on the border between France and Switzerland. This is the Geneva Airport right over here. There's one of the experiments called LHCb is here. My experiment called Atlas is based right around this area. And then I can't quite see our main competitor, CMS. They're somewhere on the other side of the ring, like around here, but I can't quite see it on this map. And then there's Lake Geneva over here. So, I mean, it gives you an idea of how big this thing is. It's 17 miles around, and it's a giant proton accelerator. Now, protons, remember, they're everywhere. They're in our atomic nuclei. A hydrogen atom is just one proton and one electron. So what they're doing is taking plain old protons and just accelerating them up to the highest energies that have ever been reached in the lab. So how much energy are we talking here? When this thing is running at full power, each proton is going to have 7 trillion electron volts of energy. And I've, for the last few lectures, I've been throwing around this term electron volts. And you know, if you guys were here on the, I think it was the second lecture where I actually explained what an electron volt was. The simplest way to imagine it is if you have a 9-volt battery and you take one electron from one side of that voltage to the other, it's going to have 9 electron volts of energy. That's the operational definition. It maybe doesn't give you a good sense of what that energy actually is. So I'm going to try to give you an idea of what that is here. Now, all right, so why am I showing a fly here? So 7 tera electron volts is about the same kinetic energy as a fly would have if it's flying along at about 1 mile per hour. So here's a fly. A fly is this many number of protons, about. The reason I got kind of fudged there and said this many numbers is because I don't know that our prefixes go this high. Some of you might know better than me about that, but I think I can go up to about 10 to the 15th or so without too much trouble. But anyway, this is 10 to the 22nd. It's let me see if I get this right. 10,000 trillion protons inside this fly. So this fly's going along at 1 mile per hour, and that energy is spread among all of those protons. And what the LHC is doing is taking the same amount of energy and packing it into one proton. So it's not that the energy is particularly high, it's just that the energy density, how compact is that energy, that's what's really high at the Large Hadron Collider. This is a picture of what the tunnel looks like. This is one of the big superconducting magnets that helps keep the protons in the ring, keeps them going around in the circle. And these magnets are they have to be so strong. They're 8 tesla, so that's like 6 to 8 times what you get in a standard MRI machine. The only way these magnets work is if they're cooled to a very low temperature so that they can be superconducting. You might remember from the third lecture, we talked a little bit about how superconductors work. So the LHC is actually the largest refrigerator in the world. It's 17 miles around, and they have these super-cooled, superconducting magnets all around the ring. Not continuously, but they're modular. But in that sense, it's the largest refrigerator on Earth. The temperature there, it's actually not just the coldest place on Earth, it's actually one of the coldest places in the universe, because even out in deep space, the temperature is not exactly zero. It's actually about 2.7 degrees above absolute zero, and that's what's giving it that temperature. It's kind of like an afterglow from the Big Bang. These very low energy photons, very low energy bits of light that are still, even out in deep space, are still there. And so it's got a very low temperature, but it's a non-zero temperature. This is colder. It's 1.9 degrees above absolute zero. So it's an impressive machine. For me, at least, it has the wow factor of, hey, this is cool, I get to work on it. Right now protons are actually colliding head-on at about half of the design energy. It's still the highest energy anywhere on Earth, the highest energy density. But in about two to three years, hopefully we'll have it upgraded to the actual full energy that it's going to run at. So what's the purpose here? The purpose is to collide protons and other protons head-on. And what happens when you do this with all of this energy is that energy can then be used into making particles, other fundamental particles that stream out of it. And this is they call an event display from the experiment that I work on, ATLAS. And this one is not super interesting, but it's it just gives you a kind of an idea of what we have to deal with. The kinds of data that we have to work with, and trying to reconstruct everything back and figure out what's going on here. What we're looking for are new fundamental particles and forces. Some of these we expect. You may have heard of the Higgs boson. We're going to talk about that a little bit more next week. But the Higgs boson is this fundamental particle that, in theory, gives mass to all of the other fundamental particles. Nobody's ever seen it. So we're hoping we see it at the LHC. What's more interesting from my perspective is, if we see something we didn't expect, that to me would be really exciting. Because we've had theorists plugging away for 30, 40 years about what might we see here, and I'm really hoping it's something that none of them ever thought. So that would be pretty neat. So this is just to give you a basic introduction about why this machine was built. Next week, we're going to get a lot more into the details of why this was built and what we hope to find. For this week, what we're going to do is focus on risk evaluation. If you're trying to do something that's never been done before, how do you know it won't have unforeseen consequences? And so so to do this, we need a little bit of risk evaluation ideas. And what I'm going to show here is, in my head, kind of how I think about evaluating risk. And I think of equations, so we're going to start with that. And I know not everyone thinks in equations, but I think we all do something similar to this when we're trying to evaluate risk. The first thing we need to know when there's a risk is the amount of badness that it's encompassing. What I mean by this is how serious are we talking? Are we talking, spilling hot coffee on yourself? Not scalding hot like you get at McDonald's, but reasonably hot coffee. That's got a fairly low badness. McDonald's, it was a while ago now, but they got a reputation for grabbing a little more badness from heating up their coffee too much. Or, you know, this could be something real serious, like losing a limb, losing life, or, you know, destroying the Earth. So if you're evaluating a risk, you have to know, all right, well, how bad is it? And you multiply that, in my mind, at least by the probability of that badness. So if we're talking the coffee example again, not too bad, but let's say you're a klutz, so your probability of badness is kind of high, your overall risk still isn't that big, because this side is low, badness is low. On the other hand, something maybe a little more closer to home is the risk of leaving your house, leaving your apartment every day. The badness there, let's take getting hit and killed by a car, that's pretty bad badness. What's the probability of that? In the U.S., it turns out per year it's a 0.0014% chance. So it's a low probability, and so we might not be conscious of this, but in some sense we're doing this math here. We're saying, all right, that's the probability of getting killed by a car as I'm walking across the street, and it's probably higher here if you live in Chicago. The streets here are not as safe as other places. So that's a big badness, but maybe a low probability. So maybe the risk is acceptable. So I want you to keep in mind, we're gonna come back to this a little bit later, but just kind of keep this in the back of your mind for now. The next question is, are there credible models, talking about the LHC destroying the world, are there credible theories about how the world could be destroyed? And the answer is, humans have kind of unlimited imagination, you can pick up any number of books on the end of the world, and actually even during the 1940s, when they were working on the Manhattan Project and creating the first atomic bomb, Edward Teller brought up this risk of, well, what if we ignite the atmosphere? Is there a chance that when we test this thing, is it going to spread throughout the Earth and destroy all the atmosphere and destroy everybody on it? People were actually worried about this. Scientists were actually worried about this for at least a little while, until they were able to go through some detailed calculations and figure out, all right, well, how dense is the atmosphere? What's the atmosphere made of? And what's the chance that this could actually happen? And in this case, it turns out that the atmosphere is too light. It's not dense enough for nuclear explosions, at least to ignite the atmosphere and set off that kind of a chain reaction. Going through this exercise of evaluating risks and deciding what's acceptable and what's not is something that is pretty important when, not just for doing science, obviously, but doing anything that's big and new. Like I said, this isn't a new thing. So for the next few minutes, we're going to talk about how to destroy the world. And yeah, Halloween's tomorrow, so this is kind of fun, right? So what you're looking at here is an artist's rendition of a black hole. That's one of the things we're going to talk about. Over here, you're seeing particle collisions from an accelerator on Long Island, and people were worried about this thing about 10 years ago before it turned on. So we'll talk about both of these and what the risks are. So first, we're going to tackle black holes. And what is a black hole? I think we have most of us have some idea of what a black hole is. It's this giant astronomical object out there somewhere in the universe that devours anything that gets close to it, because it's got so much mass. These things can have millions of times the mass of our sun. So the gravitational force is so high that nothing can escape it, not even light. That's why it's black. But to get a little more definite, what I want to do is talk about something called escape velocity. And so if you imagine the Earth sitting at the bottom of a gravitational well, we're obviously not sitting on a black hole, but it does have some gravitational pull to it, and that's kind of what I'm trying to indicate by these white lines here. And up here, where the lines essentially flatten out, that's about where the gravitational force goes away, and you can escape the gravitational pull of the Earth. So we're at the bottom of this well, and if you want to get out, it takes energy. And the amount of energy that you need to completely escape that corresponds to a certain speed, and that's what's called escape velocity. So it's pretty fast. You know, if you throw something up, if you launch something up with less than the escape velocity, it's going to come back eventually. And this is kind of a cartoon here, but you know, let's try 6,200 miles per hour. That's fast. Is it fast enough? If the Earth were the only thing in the universe and we weren't worried about other planets or other stars or anything, this is just my way of simplifying the problem. This would not be fast enough. 6,200 miles per hour, you go out to probably some pretty far distance. Actually, I haven't done the math, but it's a significant distance away from the Earth. But it wouldn't completely escape the Earth's field. You would actually, you know, this object would eventually come back, and actually when it came back, it would be traveling 6,400 miles an hour, so, or 6,200, so watch out. It turns out, if you want to completely escape the Earth's gravitational field, you need 25,000 miles per hour. Roughly, give or take a few hundred. So at this speed, this thing, an object going 25,000 miles an hour will, you know, it'll get launched out, and it'll get slower and slower and slower, and eventually, you know, if you go out to infinity, you know, to the end of space and of time, if there is such a thing, you know, then it would just stop. And if you're going faster than that, then you can definitely escape and you know, go off and do whatever you're going to do. So that's the situation for the Earth. But as you start adding more mass, and as you make this body more dense, the escape velocity here gets faster and faster. And if it gets up to 186,000 miles per second, that's the speed of light. And if light can't get out, if light can't escape, then nothing can escape, because nothing can go as fast as light. Nothing with mass. You know, other things without mass can go just as fast as light. But if you've got a black hole, the escape velocity is greater than the speed of light, and nothing's getting out. So that's what a black hole is. This is actually not a new idea. John Mitchell, in 1783, actually wrote this letter, which was read at the Royal Society of London. And he had pointed out that if, according to the equations of Newton from the 1600s, if you had something that was massive enough and dense enough, they knew that light did have a finite velocity. They knew that light was not instantaneous. And he realized, you know, if this thing has an escape velocity that's greater than that of light, we're not going to see it. They, you know, this could be out there in the universe, and we just wouldn't know about it. Now, this was before Einstein, so there was no sense of, well, can things go faster than light? The idea was, sure, things can go faster than light. So black holes in this case weren't these kind of one-way trips that we think of them as now. But the basic idea still held, even when Einstein figured out his gravitational equations. And of course, these equations now tell us that, first of all, nothing can go faster than light. And since that's the case, nothing is getting out of a black hole. So, so these things are, you know, massive, astronomical, destructive objects. You know, in that sense, they're kind of scary, but the question is, what does this have to do with the Large Hadron Collider? So can we actually make a black hole at the LHC? This is my cheap artist rendition of how that goes. The short answer is no. The long answer is yes with an if. And what's the if? We would have to relax with a certain physical principles. We would have to suspend our belief about certain things that are pretty well understood about physics. The first thing is maybe something that seems obvious at first, but it's actually maybe not as well established as we think. So the first thing is, actually before I get to that, I just want to say flat out, with three dimensions of space, you know, we've got up, down, left, right, forward, back, and one dimension of time, and with the strength of gravity as we understand it, there is just not enough energy at the LHC to produce a black hole. So with our current understanding of physics, it's It's literally impossible. What would have to be relaxed, but one of the physical principles that we'd have to watch out for is there something maybe that modifies the strength of gravity at very small scales? We think we understand how it works, but if there's something new at very small scales, then that that idea maybe could lead to black hole creation at the Large Hadron Collider. So that's one thing we have to relax. There'd have to be something modifying gravity, and one of the theories that does that is something that says we have more than three space dimensions at one time. And the idea is that gravity is actually strong, but in our three dimensions it seems weak. And then if you get to higher and higher energies, smaller and smaller scales, then maybe the other dimensions become important. So that's kind of what I'm trying to convey here. Some of you have read, if you read Brian Greene's book on the Elegant Universe, you've probably seen something like this. You know, the two-dimensional grid here is supposed to represent our three-dimensional universe, and then at each point there's this attached, these attached extra dimensions. If this is the case, then in that sense it would be possible. It opens the door at least to creating black holes at the Large Hadron Collider. But there's a second thing that would need to be relaxed in order for these black holes to be dangerous, because we know from quantum mechanics, which is fairly well understood, that that black holes actually evaporate. Now, this hasn't been observed. It's called Hawking radiation, named after Stephen Hawking. And it's based on pretty simple quantum mechanics. There's two things to remember for that. One is that black holes evaporate, and two, they evaporate faster if they're smaller. So how does this evaporation work? If you look at space on very small scales, and let's say over here, if you look at it really tiny, quantum mechanics tells you that there are actually particles and antiparticles. So for example, positrons and electrons popping in and out of existence continuously. There's a kind of a little trick in quantum mechanics that fixes the problem of conservation of energy. Quantum mechanics tells you, well, energy does have to be conserved, but if it's in a small enough time, not so much. It's a little relaxed. And so that's how you can get these particle and antiparticle pairs popping in and out of existence. Now, the interesting thing happens when you get at the edge of a black hole, and the edge there is called the event horizon. Once you go past the event horizon, you can't get out. And so if this is inside the event horizon, this is outside, you've got particle-antiparticle pairs happening all over the place. And if something happens right on this boundary, and one of the particles falls in, now this guy here doesn't have anything to annihilate with. Its partner is gone, so this actually can escape. And to an observer outside, it looks like something is actually escaping the black hole. So this it goes against our intuition a little bit. It certainly goes against Einstein, because this is now based on quantum mechanics. So if you at least take this basic version of quantum mechanics, you can actually have things leaving the black hole. And this thing is leaving with some speed, with some energy. And that energy has to come from somewhere. And in this case, it comes from the mass of the black hole. So it carries off a little bit of the mass. And for a supermassive black hole, it's not going to evaporate for something like 10 to the 60th years. I mean, it's some unthinkable amount of time because they're so big. But small black holes, if they could be created in the first place, would actually evaporate very quickly. And so if we wanted to say, well, all right, you know, if we want to believe that the LHC could destroy the world by creating small black holes, not only would there have to be more dimensions of space or time that we don't know about, there would also have to be something fundamentally wrong with our understanding of quantum mechanics, something that stopped this process from happening. So that's what I mean when I say the short answer is no, but the long answer is yes, if there's more dimensions of space and if we can ignore quantum mechanics conveniently. But once you allow extra dimensions, why not? You know, let's ignore some quantum mechanics too and see what happens. So that's black holes. This is one of the things that got a lot of press a couple of years ago. The next thing I want to talk about is a related idea, related in that it's destroying the world via some new form of matter. And the thing we want to talk about here is something called strangeness, or strange matter. And I'll try to give a flavor for what this is. This actually came to light about 10 years ago when they were commissioning what's called the Relativistic Heavy Ion Collider. It's a physics lab in, it's at a Brookhaven lab on Long Island. This lab here, what they do, instead of, you know, what we do is collide protons, and what they do is actually collide atomic nuclei like lead and gold. What they're doing is creating a really hot, dense form of nuclear matter. And thinking goes, well, what if, you know, when they're creating this hot, dense form of matter, what if they create something that's more stable than regular matter? And what might that do? So I'm going to detour a little bit. Has anyone read Cat's Cradle by Kurt Vonnegut?
Yeah.
I see, okay, a few hands, maybe up to a quarter of you. All right, so what's this book about? Really briefly, and don't worry, I'm not spoiling it for you, because this happened here in the beginning. Somebody creates a form of water, actually a form of ice. They call it Ice 9. And it's something that is, it's chemically it's the same as water, but it's a solid at room temperature. And it's more stable than liquid water at room temperature. So if you get just a little bit of this in the book, I think, I forget where they created it, in the lab or something like that. But as soon as you get a little bit of this, it can, if it comes in contact with regular water, it kind of, in a way, teaches the water how to be a solid at room temperature. And it's this cascading effect that eventually destroys the world's oceans, and then you know, if anyone touches it, you know, they effectively become a statue. So it's an end of the world story. The idea with strange matter is something similar. It's some form of matter that's more stable than regular matter that might kind of take over. Actually, before I move on, I should say that I just found this out. Kurt Vonnegut actually got his master's degree in anthropology from the University of Chicago, and he actually did it by submitting this book as, I guess, as a thesis project. So that's kind of neat, a little bit of your Chicago history. And they actually accepted a book for an anthropology master's, so that's kind of neat. All right, now this idea of something being more stable and causing this chain reaction. If you guys have seen some like heating packs, they do something like this. I'll show you what I'm talking about. I've got a small video here. This is a heat pack. You know, you disturb it a little bit, and you get this crystallization coming out of it that's kind of taking over. And what it's doing here is it's releasing heat in this process because it's being converted into something more stable. And that heat coming out, that's, you know, you can use it for sore muscles or whatever. So what's happening there is, at the beginning, there's a solution in that bottle. It's just water and some sort of salt. And what you do is you boil it, say, on your stove or something, and heat it up, and it cools down gradually. And all of that salt, it gets absorbed into the water. And then it actually wants to crystallize out once the temperature gets low enough, but it can't because it doesn't have anything to crystallize with. It needs what's called a seed. It needs something to start. And so that's in this video. That's what's happening when this person. There's like a little metal disc in there that the person's pressing, and you get just one little seed crystal, and it sets off this chain reaction. So it's the same deal for this strange matter that may or may not be created at very hot, very dense conditions. So what is it? I'll try to give you a rough idea. So we've been talking a lot about protons and neutrons the last few lectures, and so hopefully people are somewhat familiar with that at this point. You know, the idea that everything around us is made up of protons and neutrons. And it turns out, and I've alluded to this before, but that protons and neutrons are not fundamental particles in and of themselves. They have pieces, and these pieces are called quarks. Now, for the case of protons and neutrons, there are only two different types, and these were named, around the early 1960s, and so by this time, people were not giving Greek names to subatomic particles anymore, so they just called them up and down. So different combinations of these two particles make up protons and neutrons. And the only difference between protons and neutrons is, you know, how many of these guys do they have and how many of these guys. So these are the first two quarks that were, in a sense, discovered. In the late 1940s, particle physicists started seeing new types of reactions that they didn't expect. And so what did they do? They called it strange. And it turned out about something like 15 years later, the explanation came along that this was actually a new fundamental type of particle. And so they called it the strange quark, which had this property that gave them these unexpected reactions in particle collisions. And we'll get into this model. This is part of what's called the standard model, or the standard theory that's been around for about 40 years now of how particle physics works. This is part of it. The rest of it, I'll just mention it here and we'll talk about it next week. There's other quarks. There's CHARM discovered in the early 70s, BOTTOM discovered in the late 70s, and TOP was actually predicted but not discovered until 1995. We think these are the fundamental forms of matter, and there's others too. I'll get to that next week. But for now, we're just going to focus on this guy, this strange quark along with up and down. And the idea with strange matter is that it's made up of equal amounts of up, down, and strange, whereas normal matter is just made up of up and down. It's protons and neutrons. And so the idea is, you know, if you imagine in some abstract energy space, you can imagine drawing this line here. And let's say our normal matter sits in this little well, and it's stable there. And it's been stable maybe, you know, since the beginning of the universe, and we just haven't been able to get over this ridge here because we haven't had enough energy. And so the worry was at this ion collider in Brookhaven in New York, are they going to be able to make enough energy that's going to get over this ridge and fall down into this new form of matter that's more stable called strange matter? And anything it touches would get converted into more strange matter. So that was the worry. Now, what would have to be relaxed for this to be an issue? Well, one is all of the strange, any particles with, any matter with strange quarks in it decays, everything we've seen decays in about 1/10 of 1/1 billionth of 1 second. It's highly unstable. It decays almost as fast as you can produce it. So that would have to somehow be relaxed. And we know about, trying to think off the top of my head how many different types of matter with strange quarks, and it's on the order of, it's like a handful, like between five and ten different types, and all of them decay extremely rapidly. In the lab, people have also made atomic nuclei with bits of strange quarks in them, and again, those things also decay in about 1/10 of 1/1 billionth of a second. It's very fast. So all the evidence is against it already. The other thing is that the theory behind this, the theory that people came up with to get this type of matter, says that it should have a positive electric charge. I wish there were an easy reason to explain it. I couldn't get one together, but it's just, it comes out of the mathematics, really, is that this has a positive electric charge. And that would render it harmless, actually, because normal matter also has, at least the atomic nuclei, have a positive electric charge. And so they just repel each other. There wouldn't be this, you couldn't have this cascading effect because they just couldn't come into contact. The electrical repulsion would be too strong. So for this to, to be around, first it would have to have escaped our detection for the last 60 years. And second, you somehow would have to be more stable at in an electrically neutral or electrically negative form. And the theory behind it says that's not what happens. But again, it's the day before Halloween, we're playing games here. So maybe that could destroy the world. So let's go back to the risk equation now. I mean, the destruction of the world is pretty high on the badness scale. I mean, it might even be, you might call it infinite. The destruction of the Earth, that would be infinitely bad for all of us. And if that's the case, then this probability of badness really doesn't matter, because no matter how small you make this, if you've got infinity here, you're going to get infinity on the other side of your equation. So in that sense, it looks like kind of an infinite risk. Just to exemplify this, I've got a clip from The Daily Show from last year. Some of you were probably predicting what I'm going to put on here. So this is kind of short, but it gives you an idea of what we're working with here.
High school. So roughly speaking, what are the chances the world is going to be destroyed? Is it one in a million, one in a billion?
Well, the best we can say right now is about a one in two chance.
Oh, my God.
There's zero.
This is a well-respected physicist. The other guy, him.
Looked like it was time for a science off. Alice tried to dazzle me with his childish scribbles. While Walter continued to elucidate the Wagner principle.
It's a chance, it's a 50-50 chance. Yeah, you can't come back to this 50-50 thing, it's weird, Walter.
Well, if you have something that can happen, and something that won't necessarily happen, it's going to either happen or it's going to not happen.
All right, so that's the end of the clip. So John Oliver at the end says, yeah, I'm not sure that's how probability works. Right? So yeah, this guy Walter Wagner, who is leading one of the people leading the fight against turning on the Large Hadron Collider, also led the fight against turning on the relativistic heavy ion collider 10 years before. He was unsuccessful in both of those now. He was trying to get it this side, you know, he's saying, well, okay, either it'll happen or it won't, so it's 50-50. I mean, we know that's not right. I could go to Vegas and I say the chance of me winning $1 million, or I could win $1 million, or I might not, 50-50, right? Vegas will love me, but I'm not gonna win. He's right, that's not how probability works, but I'll give Walter the benefit of the doubt here and try to, I think what he was getting at is the idea that if we don't know this, if we don't know what the probability is, you know, it might as well be 50-50. I mean, he could have even, you know, gone farther and said, if we don't know the probability, you know, maybe it's 80%, maybe it's 100%. So I think that's, you know, I'm trying to be somewhat fair to him, although, I mean, it was an amusing clip. I mean, to be fair, I think he was trying to say that we don't know what the probability is, and so we have no way of evaluating the risk at all. At least that, you know, putting it in its best light, I think that's what you can say. You know, not only is that not how probability works, it's actually not true. We actually do have the tools to evaluate what the risk is, and this is what I'm getting at with how scientists think about problems. We're going to use what we know to put a limit on this risk of the idea that the LHC could destroy the Earth. And it's not just going to be a limit on the risk from strange matter, or black holes. It's going to be a limit based on, or it's going to limit the possibility that the world could be destroyed by anything, whether we thought of it or not, anything at all related to proton collisions at the Large Hadron Collider. And how do we do that? We actually use something called cosmic rays, or cosmic radiation. This was discovered in the early 1900s. Victor Hess got the Nobel Prize for discovering it in 1936. So what is it? He noticed that at higher and higher altitudes, he detected more radiation. It appeared to be coming from space. And so it was called cosmic radiation. We also call it cosmic rays. That's a little misleading now. The name stuck, but it's not really a ray of anything. It's actually matter. It's actually, let me see if I have it on this slide. Yeah. It's actually just different types of atomic nuclei, really. So most of it is protons, 89% is just regular old protons. That's what we're colliding at the LHC. 10% is helium nuclei, also known as alpha radiation, alpha particles. But it's just the atomic nucleus of helium. And then the remaining small 1% is heavier nuclei, like the nuclei of iron, for example. So these are constantly being produced and streaming in towards us and bombarding the Earth. So where are they produced from? One major source is supernovas. This is when a star gets, it runs out of fuel, basically, and starts collapsing in on itself. And the that extra energy from the gravitational collapse can actually ignite fusion of different nuclei. So say if stars start off burning hydrogen, then they might start burning for helium and you know have a supernova. I see a question. I'm going to ask to hold questions until the end, just because I got a little distracted last time. So sorry. But we can definitely come back to that. So you get these vast, huge, energetic supernova explosions, and they end up releasing things like protons and helium nuclei and heavy nuclei. And that's what's constantly streaming and bombarding the Earth. So what happens? You know, these cosmic rays, and I'm going to focus on protons, they can hit an atomic nucleus up in the atmosphere and set off this whole shower of unstable particles. I mean, this looks like the kind of physics I do. This is particle physics. It's just in the upper atmosphere. Most of these are unstable and they decay away very quickly. A few of these products actually make it down to ground level, and there's actually about 100 of these products going through your body every second from cosmic rays. You know, the building's not a whole lot of shielding, and especially when you go outside, you know, these are just streaming through you, you don't care. So cosmic radiation in and of itself, or the products of it, are not really risky to us. But they are useful in figuring out how dangerous or not the Large Hadron Collider is. So what we're going to do is, we're going to make an analogy here. It's actually not an analogy, this is a direct connection. So in the atmosphere, this is what's happening. You have a proton hitting an atomic nucleus, and let's say it hits another proton. It doesn't really matter whether it hits a proton or a neutron, but just to be the same as the Large Hadron Collider, we're just going to think of protons for now. So it does that. There's a little burst of energy, and you know you saw this shower of particles come out of it. That's exactly the same, physically exactly the same process as what's happening at the Large Hadron Collider. You have protons of some energy coming in and creating a little flash, and then you might remember from the beginning that event display I showed felt these particles coming out. It's the same thing, protons, and then down here at the LHC, also protons. Of course, what's different is the energy. I tried to give you a flavor at the beginning for how much energy we're talking about here. And the question is there anything comparable in the atmosphere with that energy? And the answer is yes. So what you're seeing here is the energy distribution of cosmic rays, and I'll try to break it down for you a little bit. You know, down here, they're saying that cosmic rays of a bit over 1 billion electron volts, that's a small fraction of what's happening at the LHC, you get about one of those for every square meter every second. So if this table is 2 or 3 square meters, there's 2 or 3, you know, if this were up in the atmosphere, there'd be 2 or 3 cosmic rays of this energy, a little over a billion electron volts, passing through every second, 2 or 3. And you see this thing falls off pretty quickly. You know, down here at a higher energy, you know, it's 1 every square meter per year. Okay, so it's, you know, it falls off fast. And down here, they have 1 every square kilometer per year. So, you know, these things, once we get down into this range, it's pretty rare. And actually, so for cosmic rays to pack the same punch as the particles colliding at the Large Hadron Collider, they actually need to be here, around 10 to the 17 electron volts. So a little more frequent than 1 per kilometer, square kilometer per year. But that's all around the Earth, and these things are constantly bombarding the Earth. The Earth is a big place. So it turns out there's actually 250,000 of these cosmic rays hitting the atmosphere every second that have as much energy as the Large Hadron Collider or more. 250,000 every second. So in that sense, nature has been performing LHC-style experiments since the beginning of the Earth. You know, I'm using the atmosphere here. It doesn't have to be an atmosphere. It can be just, you know, matter on the Earth, you know, from, you know, so it's not an issue of whether we have atmosphere or not. It's whether you have protons hitting other protons. And the Earth has been around for 4.5 billion years. So it's actually been quite a while that you've had these cosmic rays coming down and hitting the Earth. And so for 4.5 billion years, 250,000 a second, That works out to a 3 with 22 zeros after it, 3 times 10 to the 22 cosmic rays of LHC energy or higher that have hit the Earth since the Earth was formed. Now, how does that compare to the number of collisions at the Large Hadron Collider? If we're optimistic and assume the best estimates for how many collisions of protons the LHC will have over its projected 20 to 30 years of operation, if we're optimistic about that, then the Earth has already done 100,000 times more than anything we're ever going to do at the Large Hadron Collider. We're going to do experiments for about 30 years, and you know, you can't compete with 4.5 billion years. The Earth is just, you know, it's been accumulating this. So if you turn that logic around and try to go back to the risk equation, what can we say about probability there? You can, in some sense, you can say that there's a, you know, no more than a 1 in 100,000 chance that the LHC would destroy the Earth based on cosmic rays. And that's okay. That's not 1 in 100,000. It's low, but you know, is it low enough? That's actually comparable to the risk of an individual person in the U.S. Getting killed by a car as a pedestrian in 1 year. It's about a 1 in 100,000 chance. So we don't, you know, if we're talking about the world ending, we don't want to have that be our cutoff for the probability. We would want it less probable than that. So you can actually take the same math here that I did for the Earth, you can do it for the Sun, because we know the Sun is still here. At least it was as of 8 minutes ago. Yeah, I'm glad some of you got that. But we can do the same math for the Sun. Now, the Sun is a lot bigger. You can fit 100 Earths across the diameter of the Sun here. And if you're talking about surface area, you know, it's many factors larger than the Earth. So if you do the same math, cosmic rays hitting the Sun for 4.5 billion years, it turns out that in that case, you have about 1 billion LHC experiments that have happened since the Sun came into existence, 1 billion. So now if your chance of destroying the Earth is less than 1 in a billion, still probably too high for some people, but it's the same chance of me dying by simultaneously getting in a car accident and being hit by a bolt of lightning at the same time, and both of those things together killing me. So that's what 1 in a billion is like. And so I think for most people, certainly for me going out driving, this is an acceptable risk, you know, 1 in a billion. But we can do even better than this. You know, we don't have to stop at the Sun. We can see hundreds and thousands and trillions of, well, maybe not trillions, lots of galaxies. I have to check, I'm not an astronomer, but it may be trillions, actually. There's a lot of galaxies out there, and we can see them. We know that they haven't they haven't been destroyed by cosmic rays hitting them. And so if you do the math and crank through this a little bit more, there are 30 trillion equivalents of LHC experiments going on in the universe every second. 30 trillion per second, and the universe is 13.5 billion years old. So I think now this gets into the realm of acceptable risk. It's true we do see black holes out here, but we see no evidence of small black holes or microscopic black holes or even something that is being triggered from cosmic ray collisions. We don't see any evidence of matter besides protons and neutrons. Now, there's an exception to that we'll talk about next week called dark matter, but it's not something that's going to convert everything to itself. It's stable. So we don't see any of these runaway cascade effects out in the universe. We do see, like I said, we see black holes, we see supernovas. So I mean, we do see vast destruction in some areas, but with 30 trillion LHC equivalent experiments happening every second. I think we can safely say at this point that there's no risk that the LHC is going to destroy the Earth. I guess I do hope I've convinced you of that, but it, more so than convincing you, my goal is not to convince you really. My goal is to show you this is how scientists go about thinking about problems. How do we use something we do know, the observation of cosmic rays, to put a bound on what we don't know? We don't know what's going to happen at the LHC. I hope it's something that we haven't thought of yet. I have people who are looking, I know people, sorry, who are looking for black holes at the LHC, and you know, they're not, so in that sense they're hoping to see them, and they're not worried about, you know, the LHC destroying the Earth. So the point is this is a flavor for how scientists think about these problems, even if it's something as blatant as, well, we're still here, and what does that say about probability of total destruction? And if I've seemed a little cavalier, a little lighthearted about this, it's because for the purpose of the LHC at least, so many standbys, so many basic principles of physics would have to be relaxed or gone for something horrible to happen. Now that being said, future experiments in not just physics, but anything else that does something new, should do this kind of an exercise. I mean, it's actually, the math is not that hard. It's just, you know, keeping track of how many 10 to the 20 whatever you're carrying around. But it's, you know, you can do it on one sheet of paper. So I think, you know, people can go through this and do these calculations to defend the basic safety of what it is they're working on. So I think assured that the LHC won't destroy all of civilization, we're going to start talking next week about why we built the LHC and what we hope to find. So thanks for your attention. The comment is there's high energy photons also, bits of light coming from various places in the universe. And yes, I haven't mentioned those. You could do the same thing actually. High energy photons also set off spectacular showers of particles in our atmosphere. We actually don't know the sources of all of these high energy photons. We suspect some of them come from supernovas, but some of them have such a high energy that we can't imagine where they're coming from. And so that's actually an unsolved problem in astrophysics. I think for the purposes of this assessment, cosmic rays, protons are just more plentiful. There's just more of them. And so it's easier to set a limit. I see your comment. Yes, it would be rays of energy. Yeah, I see. They're not matter. They're light. Yes, that's a good point. Yeah, and they are a component of what can collectively be called cosmic radiation. Yeah. You had a question.
I live by actual measurement 2 miles from the second largest K-Fermi collider.
At Fermi collider. Okay. Yeah.
And over the summer, they've been narrowing the range of energies for the big supply to be found for data analysis.
Yes.
And I'm happy to a couple days ago, I'm sure there's some Senate committee appropriated $35 million to keep it running for 3 more years.
Not quite.
Getting there.
So for some background on this, Fermilab, which until recently was the highest energy particle accelerator in the world, 40, 50 miles from here, it was originally going to shut off at the end of next year, at the end of 2011. And the reason is just, there's so much more energy available at the Large Hadron Collider that to the funding agencies it doesn't necessarily make sense to keep running Fermilab if you're not getting as much return for what you're putting into it. And Fermilab is changing their priorities. They want to focus on different types of physics, not particle collisions with protons, but actually they want to learn more about neutrinos. And hopefully we'll have some time next week to talk about neutrinos. Recently there's been a push because Fermilab is getting so close to ruling out various masses that the Higgs boson could have. That makes some people think that, you know, they have actually a pretty good shot of maybe seeing it before we see it at the Large Hadron Collider. And so there's this push to run Fermilab for another 3 years. Now they haven't appropriated $35 million. They said, if we can find $35 million in the budget, then we should run Fermilab for 3 more years. And we're actually, I mean, there is a lot of strong support for that, but there's that big if, and you know, with the economy the way it is, and the federal budget the way it is, there's no guarantee. So we'll see how it works out. Incidentally, feel free to write members of Congress and let them know if you want Fermilab to be extended. So other questions? Yes? I'm sorry, could people speak down, or speak lower here, and could you speak up, please?
Yeah, I'll do my best. Is there any chance of capturing cosmic rays and using them as a source of energy?
Not as a source of energy. So the problem is for cosmic rays to be used as a source of energy, the idea of capturing them doesn't do much for you, because as soon as you capture them, to me at least, that implies stopping. And once they're stopped, that energy is dissipated. The energy that they have is only in their speed. It's in how fast they're going. I don't think there's any way we could use them as a source of energy. I think, you know, we're much better off. You know, solar power, for example, is a lot easier to use as a source of energy. So although these things are individually very energetic, and there actually may be a pretty good amount of energy streaming into the atmosphere, it's just I don't think it's possible to harness it, at least not with technology that we have. So, yeah, question back here.
Could you give us an idea of how many protons are in the streams that are collided to result in the jets and the cascades?
Yeah, I'll try. So when I showed you that event display at the beginning, that was from a single collision of protons. But they do fill up the ring with what they call trains of protons, and that, you know, you don't just have one going around at a time. You have a whole bunch, and you just collide them together really rapid fire. What they do is they send what they call bunches of protons, and it's a very thin, like the width of a human hair, probably thin stream of protons about maybe this long, in that stream of protons there's about 10 to the 11th, so that's 100 billion protons. Sounds like a lot, but on the scale of matter, it's not very much. So that's one bunch of protons, 100 billion. And they actually fill up, eventually they're going to be able to fill up about 2,800 bunches of protons all circulating at the same time. So 2,800 times 100 billion. So it's a large number of protons, and the total stored energy in that is actually very high. You know, for one proton, it's a fly moving at 1 mile per hour. So now 100 billion times 2,800 protons, that's actually a lot of energy. I've heard it compared to an aircraft taxiing at 25 miles per hour. I think that's the relevant number. So it's, that one's hard to imagine, because it's a large object, but it's slow moving. So, but anyway, I mean, it's either way, it's a lot of energy. It's enough energy to maybe damage the machine if we're not careful. It's not enough energy to damage anything around it. The machine is 300 feet underground, so even if something catastrophic happened on that side, and that's actually more of a risk of just us breaking our own machine, you know, and it's happened before, so but nothing that we couldn't recover from. So it is a lot of energy. It's a lot of protons.
And not every stream or burst of protons is actually going to end up making a collision.
Right. They will attempt collisions eventually 40 million times a second. There's actually, in terms of actual collisions, it's actually a fairly high percentage of that actually does collide. I don't remember the number off the top of my head, but you do get at least several million potentially interesting things every second. So then there's a huge, you know, infrastructure to analyze these things in real time and throw away what we don't need, because we can only write a certain amount onto disk at the end of the day. But we'll hopefully time to talk about that in a week or two also, about how the data taking actually works. So I think I saw one other hand in the middle, maybe not. Oh, sorry, yes.
This is a technical question.
Okay.
So you see the circular track of the collider.
Yes.
But each, there must be straight sections that keep turning, because you cannot go in a curve with it.
That's a good point, yeah.
How long are these
things? Oh, that's a good question. That's a good question, I think, because I'm stumped. So the question is, we have a circular collider, but as he's correctly pointing out, it's not completely circular. There are straight sections and curved sections. And I can tell you that the magnets that we use, each magnet is 15 meters long, so 45 feet or so. But I believe the straight sections are, well actually that would be in a curving section, because the magnet actually bends the path of the proton. Off the top of my head, I don't know how long the straight sections are, yeah. I mean, you can see from the two images, the aerial image and also the image from inside the tunnel, it does approximate a circle pretty well, but I'll try to find that out for you, find out how long the straight sections are. All right, so I think we have time for one more question. Yeah.
How big was the superconducting super collider supposed to be?
Yeah, the superconducting super collider was, you might remember this, it was supposed to be the next great American particle collider after Fermilab, and unfortunately it was the funding for it was cut in 1993, and so at that point American physicists started focusing on CERN and the LHC. It was supposed to collide protons at a total energy of 40 tera electron volts. At the LHC we're doing 14, so it was going to be around three times higher energy. And I think it was supposed to be something like twice as big around, like 40 miles or so around. It was really impressive. And they had actually, this is the sad part, they'd actually dug the tunnel for it. I mean, they had this 40-mile tunnel. And I think most of the tunnel's still there. I think they tried to fill in, I don't know, some of it, maybe the access ports. But yeah, so it was actually a fair amount of work that went in before it was cut. But anyway, so sorry, long answer. I think the short answer is about, I think it was 40 miles. Sorry, Congress.
Fill the tunnel with congressmen.
Oh, fill the tunnel with congressmen. So yeah, they cut off the funding, maybe. All right. I'm not going to say anything that'll get me in trouble. So all right. So I think that's all we have time for. So I'll leave you with Happy Halloween. This is my daughter dressed as a sushi.